In this video, I'm going to try something I don't believe anyone has ever made a video of before. I have this very special microphone that is able to record frequencies 5 times wider than what a normal microphone can do, 5 times higher frequencies. That means that it is going to go way into the ultrasonic range, even beyond what cats and dogs can normally hear. So then I'm going to actually use this to record certain things that produce ultrasonic sounds, then I can squash those sounds down into the audible human range so we can actually hear what they sound like on a relative basis, at least like never before. And I've got several different things here, so it should be pretty cool. But to be clear, this is not a review of any of these devices. It's literally just focusing on the ultrasonic sound aspect of them. I have no idea if these actually work for their intended purpose. So first, a quick explanation on how this microphone and everything is going to work. Basically, when you go to record audio, depending on the program you're using, you can have a spectrum view of the recording. And with this, instead of seeing just a waveform of the loudness of different parts, you can actually see the loudness based on the actual specific frequency in that part of the audio. So it's kind of like a heat map. So it's time in one dimension, frequency in another, and then the color determines the loudness. Now, a normal microphone is going to top out at maximum of like around 20 kilohertz, this range here. And that's because human hearing typically tops out absolute maximum at around 20 kilohertz. And actually most adults will top out between 15 and 17 kilohertz, depending on age, but it could be even lower. However, this microphone here is very different. This is the Sanken CO-100k, and like the name suggests, it can go up to 100 kilohertz. Now, considering I just said that humans can only hear up to 20 kilohertz or so max, you might be wondering why this would even be useful. So let me give a demonstration. Say you're making a scary horror movie or something, and you need monster sounds. So you want to make monster sounds with a normal voice and then pitch it down to make it sound all scary. So that's what I'm doing for this demonstration. I'm using the Shure SM7B, a very popular podcasting microphone, as well as the Sanken CO-100k. And then I recorded them simultaneously, and I'm gonna pitch it down about 60%, so it sounds very low and monster-like. So now I'll just play them back to back, and you can tell me if you can tell the difference. So yeah, big difference. As you probably heard, the 20 kilohertz microphone, when you squash it down, it sounds almost like it's underwater because there's no higher tones. But when you take the 100 kilohertz, squash it down, you still kind of have that full 20 kilohertz range, even though it's squashed so down, so it actually sounds more realistic. So that's one example of where this might be useful. Another one is if you're making sound effects by recording various things, like, I don't know, snapping a twig, you want to make it sound more dramatic, then having that extra range to squash and move around the pitch can be very helpful. And to give a bit of perspective for how other animals hear, a cat apparently can hear up to around 79 kilohertz, whereas a dog can hear up to maybe around 45 kilohertz, though this is going to vary by the breed of the animal, as well as the individual frequency. Some are more sensitive than others. So anyway, with this microphone, we can easily hear into the range that normally only animals can. Now, interestingly, when I was looking around for things around the house that would produce ultrasonic sounds, there aren't really that many. However, there are several products and devices that are specifically designed to produce ultrasonic sounds, which is what I focused on here. Now, one quick last point I want to make before we get into that is to be clear that when you record the microphone with 100 kilohertz frequency or whatever, if you were to play it back on a speaker that could even do that, you still wouldn't be able to hear it, even though you recorded it, because it's still above that frequency range. So we still have to process it and pitch it down to be able to hear those frequencies. And because of that, it's not like we can ever truly hear what these things would sound like to a dog or a cat with that natural hearing range. It's just going to be more of a relative basis, but it still gives, I think, a good idea. You can still imagine what it would sound like. For example, you can still imagine whether this would sound annoying or not. So you'll see what I mean. So let me quickly go through the devices that I have and we're gonna be testing. So first of all, we have two different dog whistles. So these are gonna produce probably slightly different sounds. I also have two different anti-barking devices for dogs. So these produce different frequencies in the inaudible range to humans, but dogs can hear it, and supposedly they make a dog stop barking. And then finally, I have these two different ultrasonic rodent repellent devices. So apparently these produce frequencies that rodents, or I think maybe even bugs or something, it claims, and it's supposed to scare them away or keep them away within that range. Though a quick warning to anyone with headphones on or loud speakers, be ready to change the volume knob because some of these are a bit obnoxious sounds. Okay, so let's start off with the metal dog whistle, and I'll just play it as recorded, no manipulation. So it's mostly just a hissing sound, but you can sort of slightly hear a whistle sound on the high end. And now I'll play it back with a 80% pitch reduction. So still nothing too crazy, it more just kind of sounds like blowing through a straw. It's pretty uniform, I think, which kind of makes sense if this is advertised as a dog training whistle. It's not really meant to annoy them, just kind of make them more easily hear it, and I guess that makes sense. Next, we can try the red dog whistle, so I'll play that here normally. So this one is definitely more in the human audible range. It sounds more like a regular whistle. And then here is this one also reduced by 80%. This one definitely has more of a focused tone, I would say, a more distinct tone. But other than that, it's not all too different from the previous whistle. Okay, next up, I have these two electronic dog whistle type devices, and these are actually kind of interesting. Though, based on the recordings that I made, I do believe these have the same, if not a very similar, sound module, so they produce pretty much the same exact tone, so I'm just going to talk about them together. When you go to use it, it effectively has no audible sound to a human, so there's no point in playing it back. You're not going to hear anything. But when recording it, you can see that it produces a really wacky looking spectrum. However, I don't believe these lines are actually real. They're probably what are called harmonics, and also a result of what is called aliasing, which for some reason seems to occur when the audio is clipping too loud. So basically that's when this thing is too close to the microphone. When I backed up across the room, all these wacky looking lines disappeared and I was left with just a very solid line on the 25 kilohertz. There is another thinner line at 50 kilohertz, but considering that is even outside the range of dog hearing, I believe that is another harmonic artifact. So I believe basically these both just produce a single frequency at 25 kilohertz and that's it. Oh, and you audio experts out there, yes, I am recording at 192 kilohertz, the maximum my audio interface does support, so I am getting that frequency range in there. Okay, so now we can see what frequency this thing is producing, and now we can pitch it down 80%. So get ready to maybe turn down the headphones a little bit. This is annoying. So as you can hear, it sounds more of like a flat single tone. However, it does not sound exactly like a regular sine wave, a smooth sine wave. This sounds a little bit more annoying than that, so it probably would be annoying for animals hearing it as well. And I think that probably makes sense considering this is meant to like stop barking. It probably is supposed to sound slightly annoying. And also I'll point out when I pitched it down, these other random bands appear, and I believe these are also not truly there. They're just a result of recording artifacts. All right, so next we can talk about the two different rodent repellent devices, and I'm not gonna name any brand names because again, these aren't a review. And also these seem to be kind of generic devices that are produced under multiple brand names, so it doesn't really matter anyway. So first we have this blue one, and this one actually is pretty interesting. It isn't really what I was expecting. Now, like the electronic dog whistle things, I could not hear this at all naturally, but when I was recording it, the waveform was very interesting to see developing. You can see it is not just a single tone, but it actually rises in tone from around 25 kilohertz to 65 or 70 kilohertz, I'd say. It kind of varies a little bit, but that is pretty much consistent with the back of the device that says 25 to 74 kilohertz range. So then I lower it by 85% to get a better idea of what this actually sounds like to rodents, and I'll let you hear that right now. So basically, it seems like every 400 milliseconds or so, it increases the tone frequency by around 100 hertz, and then goes up to 65 to 75 kilohertz, then stops for about 10 seconds, and then starts right over from 25 up again. So that's definitely kind of interesting. Although one thing I noticed is a lot of these anti-rodent devices say that they're pet safe and that pets won't be annoyed by it, but I don't see how that is possible because they're in the hearing range of pets. So if you're going to be using these, I would kind of observe if you have a cat or dog, if they seem to be avoiding the thing or annoyed by it, then they probably are, and you might want to reconsider that. All right, and finally we have this other one. It's also a plug-in, and this one was definitely disappointing. It doesn't seem to really fully work. It's supposed to have three different settings for what it calls a slight, middle, or heavy infestation. So, good idea in theory, and the frequency range it states is 22 to 50 kilohertz. So those are definitely outside the human hearing range. You shouldn't be able to hear it. However, when I went to test both of the lower two settings, I didn't see anything. It didn't seem to produce any sounds at all. And I thought, okay, maybe it's intermittent, maybe like the previous one. So I gave it like a good 5 minutes and it produced nothing that I saw at all. So I don't know if my unit is just defective, but it's not exactly encouraging, and you wouldn't exactly know if it's even working or not if you bought this normally. Now on the red setting, I immediately was able to tell that it was doing something, but that's because I could actually hear it, which obviously I don't think is supposed to happen. And yes, it was very annoying. And here's what that sounds like. As you can hear and see, the sound oscillates from 30 kilohertz, dipping way down to around 12 kilohertz, which most people will be able to hear that. And it's also way outside the stated range of the device, which says it bottoms out at 22 kilohertz, but it goes down to like 12. And I also want to quickly point out, I believe it's just producing one waveform, and the other ones here are just harmonics again. They're not actually there. Now with that recording, most likely you heard it go up and then kind of stop and then come back down again. But if we lower it by 85%, we can actually hear that it is one continuous oscillation. So let me play that back pitched down. So I think that's kind of interesting. Before, you couldn't hear it into the top ranges, but then when you bring it down, you can actually hear the whole thing. So because it's changing, and if it's at least as annoying as we think it is, a rodent probably would be deterred by this thing. If it was actually in the range that it stated, which it's not, it goes into the human hearing range, which in my opinion just makes it completely useless to have around the house. I would not want this thing around. And I don't believe this is just a defective unit fully, because reading some reviews, they did state that they could hear it in the red mode as well. So I don't know. I would not recommend this device if you see it, obviously. Still though, I was definitely very interested while doing all these tests, and hopefully you were too. So let me know what you think down in the comments, and if you know of any particularly unique ultrasonic sounds that you might think might be worth making additional videos about, then let me know down there. I'll consider it. And if you're thinking about subscribing, also be sure to click the bell next to the subscribe button. I make videos about once or twice a week. You don't want those getting lost in the rest of your subscriptions. Now, if you guys want to keep watching, if you kind of like these sort of scientific test type things, the next video I'd recommend is one where I was doing a review of a water-cooled mattress that I got recently, well, last year, and I did a whole thermal imaging test of it. I think it was pretty cool, so I'll put that link right there. So thanks so much for watching, guys, and I'll see you in the next video.